Awesome. So a couple things right before we jump into it. One, please keep your cell phones on silent, just as a courtesy for the speakers. There are mics throughout the room, so hopefully they should be able to pick up everything you said. If there isn't, we'll repeat the questions. And please keep your masks on at all times. With that, I'll kick it off to Jan, who can introduce the panel. I'm looking forward to this discussion.
All right. Welcome, everybody. I'm sorry. What? Oh, the Chatham House rules. What are the Chatham House rules? Okay. Well, no rules here. No, I maybe that's not a. All right, so we are here to talk about kind of emerging topics in cyber policy. Now, I'm Jan Shortashvili. Some might know me as Zardes, and we'll go and introduce ourselves. And the general idea, I'm a professor at Arizona State University. When we say emerging topics in blah in a class, it means we're just going to teach anything, right? It's just a catch-all for whatever. So hopefully that won't be this. We'll be a little more structured about actual security policy topics. But why don't we start with introductions by my co-panelists, and we'll go from there.
All right. Confusingly, I'm also Jan, so you only have to remember one last name here. I used to work at the EFF with Kurt over there doing the technology side of policy. So we made things like Let's Encrypt. We helped out with the Tor project, et cetera. And now I run security at Brave Software, which is a browser company.
Good afternoon. My name is Luis Eduardo. My day trade is I run the product security for a large networking company, and my other job here is to run the network team, so that's what I do.
I'm Bill Woodcock. I'm the executive director at Packet Clearinghouse, and we do sort of internet critical infrastructure and the policy around that.
Quad 9 in the house.
Yeah, Quad 9 also. That's like our consumer facing.
About 130
CCTLDs? Yeah. 150. It's over 150 now.
So basically half the world's CCTLDs.
Hey, everybody. My name is Kurt Opsahl. I am the Deputy Executive Director and General Counsel at the Electronic Frontier Foundation. EFF has been working on tech policy issues for, founded in 1990. I work a lot with this community through our Coders Rights Project, trying to provide counsel on legal issues to security researchers about doing their research and about the issues surrounding disclosing it, especially if the vendor is upset or there are people who want that information not disclosed. So we try and fight for things like free speech and privacy and innovation policy and try and making the world a better place through good law and policy. And technology too, which John helped with.
And I'm Jeff Moss, founder of DEF CON, and really happy to see people here. This is our attempt to really try to increase the engagement between the technical community and policy-minded individuals. And I hope it moves us past the sort of tourist phase of us kind of cursorily looking at each other, moving into a more substantial way in which we can interact and help each other. And what really galvanized my thoughts around this area was the success our vote hacking machine village had in influencing not just policy in the United States around voting machines, but globally. And it turned out that our simple little report impacted that space in one weekend more than a decade of a lot of activist groups trying to raise awareness. And it turns out that you can tell people the plate is hot, but until they touch it and burn their finger, it doesn't count. And so by us in one weekend hacking and successfully compromising these voting machines was more important than a decade of people saying out loud that these machines are vulnerable. And so I think there's a lot of what we're trying to do is speak truth to power and provide a third party kind of more neutral perspective, because I don't think policy gets that. I think policy gets a lot of trade associations and self-interest, and civil society doesn't have a big voice, and that's what we're trying to do.
Cool.
So from that perspective, I'm going to do my best moderating my moderation experience. I was in a couple rooms over. I ran CTF for 4 years, and that mostly involves screaming at teams that are misbehaving. So I'll try to do that as little as possible. I'm a very loud person by nature, but let's kind of start things off. So, you know, Jeff, you said the voting machine village, and that was a great example of something very practical that informed policy down the line once it came out, right? And so in some sense, it would be great if one of the outcomes of this roundtable discussion were ideas of potentially future villages that we can do to then inform people down the line. So I'll start with one thing that actually I got administrative pressure for the other day. Unless you have an idea on direction to go initially.
No, I was just going to say the reason of the success of the voting village was completely random. I mean, I would like to take credit for it being such a success, but until the year before 2015, there was no exception in the DMCA for good faith research or security research and critical infrastructure and voting infrastructure. And that's why people weren't hacking this stuff. It was against the law. And so the Library of Congress put in this exemption for the DMCA. So now it's legally possible, but you can't get the machines. There's not enough machines, they're not available, they're only sold under contract. The whole system is designed to make sure nobody ever figures out how these ancient machines work. But there was a storm, much like in Las Vegas. The storm collapsed the roof of a warehouse where a county was storing their voting equipment. The insurance company totaled the equipment, and because they were a green insurance company, they sent out the zero value items to get recycled at a RePC company. That electronic recycler is like, well, they still work. I'll sell them for $200 and just start selling them on eBay. So now the law has changed and they're available. The manufacturer catches on that this is happening and goes to them and says, you have to return them all to us. And he says, great, okay, $200, how many do you want? They're like, no, there are machines. You have to return them to us. He's like, well, I've never signed those agreements. I got them legally from the insurance company. No. It's like, well, then you have to destroy them because they have proprietary parts. He's like, okay, $200 an hour. How many do you want me to destroy? He's like, no, we don't want to pay for it. And he says, well, then we're selling. And so because the voting companies didn't want to pay for the machines, they got out. And we had our success. And so I think since then, they've recognized the importance of that exception under the DMCA, and they want to expand that, right? So that was a very tangible law changes, machines available, look at this outcome. And I'd like to see those kind of exceptions expanded, if possible. Because in other countries, you can't do this, right?
Yeah. Well, I think an interesting event that I very nearly witnessed in my first DEF CON, but I stepped out of the room and my brother witnessed it instead, was Dmitry Skryarov being arrested basically on stage after disclosing something Adobe didn't want disclosed, right? This doesn't happen anymore because as a society, we've kind of grown up and accepted vulnerability research and proper disclosure channels and you know, when to pull the parachute and you know, tweet the bug.
I mean, not to hijack every conversation, but that was interesting because Dmitry was an employee for a company, Elcomsoft, in Russia. In Russia, there was a law that allowed you to make a personal backup of your software for your own safety. And so they made tools to allow Russians to make that backup, right? To crack a lot of protections. PDF files, I think, were the thing that Adobe didn't like. So they were in some kind of argument, and Adobe's like, well, we're in Russia and it's legal here. And Adobe didn't like that. So when their employee came into the States, they got the FBI to arrest an employee as a proxy for the company. And then all these protests started. And Adobe went to the FBI and said, oh, okay, we don't want to prosecute anymore. And the federal government's like, well, that's not your choice. That's, you know, a state issue now. You started it, but... And so now Adobe flips around and now they're on his side. And they're the ones that created the whole mess because the PR disaster was so great. And so I'm sure you have stories like that, but the policy outcomes can kind of end up being very bizarre.
Yeah, seems like what we're all homing in on here is the difference between public interest and private interest and the government's role in, you know, which side of that fight the government comes down on. And I think, you know, many of us would really like to see the government acting more in the public interest more of the time and less in the pocket of some private interest like, you know, Adobe or whoever, John Deere. You know, there are a lot of different kinds of areas in which this comes up. The right to repair stuff is a lot of it. A lot of it is around misuse of intellectual property law to keep people from, you know, advancing the state of the art. You know, something Kurt and I worked on, 3 years ago now, was there was a private equity firm that tried to do a hostile takeover of the entire .org domain, right? Like, yeah. So that they could charge every nonprofit in the world, you know, the maximum possible amount of money for their domain name, which, like, the Red Cross was pretty scared by that, given the size of their budget, right? And, you know, the government didn't really have anything to say about that. And public to make sure that people are paying attention to the public's interest.
So I wanted to add into this, like how could we go forward? So we've seen a couple of these barriers. There are, so the DMCA has been a barrier. They have a rulemaking process every 3 years where you can try and get some exemptions from the DMCA. And, you know, that is a process which has made a number of good strides forward, but it still is a restrictive process. The DMCA impedes a number of possible research paths. Or at least we would like to see that expanded. But I think also one of the things coming out of the voting villages is that, like, the public got interested and then the government got interested in having it happen. And I think this could be expanded to other areas. And I see some of this, like the aerospace village here and the car hacking village, bringing some things in. We've had some trouble in the past, like with aerospace, where, you know, they don't want people hacking on their planes. Certainly not, you know, a live plane. But I think it would be great to get these industries involved, willing to open up their systems to have security research, do it so that, you know, there's some rules around it. So it's a plane, for example, that is not in flight, but rather parked and safely done. And then that research would be, you know, published in a forum like this, give them a time to fix the flaws before they go out there, but have that kind of cooperation with people who are otherwise hesitant or might, like the voting industry for a while was basically threatening people if they went ahead and did this research, flip that around. And I think that might be, you know, corporations need to change on this, but also I think it would be great to get, you know, policy support from all around, from government levels, to see this is a good thing. We want to make that happen, make the environment in which it can happen.
So how do we make that flip happen, right? I guess Adobe flipped due to public pressure. Do we have the bandwidth as a DEF CON community to public pressure?
And the normal trajectory has always been researcher finds flaw in X, mm-hmm. access control system, physical lock system, right? What have we got? Medical, implantable medical devices, whatever it is, manufacturing people freak out. Threatened lawsuits are successful or not, right? They get the Boston students to withdraw their access control talk on the subway system, or they, you know, physical HID got some talks pulled on access control stuff, right? And then EFF gets involved and the media starts reporting, and pretty soon the manufacturers realize they can't keep doing this. Mm-hmm. Like, the cat's out of the bag, people know their stuff. And it's like a forced maturation, and it's painful. And they didn't all grow up at once. It started with like network and operating system companies. But I remember when it was access control, and then now it's been aviation and cars, and like, it's so painful, but they all follow the same trajectory, it seems. And at some point, we're going to run out of industries, I hope, and we'll all finally...
There's a first contact issue to solve. Like, when an industry has not previously been in contact with the security world, they're always nervous at first contact. So maybe one way is to think about what are the first contacts and how to make that run smoothly. Because we've seen just so many industries where, it goes badly at first. And this oftentimes comes in an industry that previously did not think about computer security. In fact, many of them didn't have something that had much computers in it like 20, 30 years ago, but now everything has a computer in it. So many of them are connected to devices, and then they're getting treated like a computer company, as they should, because that's where their security problems are, but their like PR and their lawyers are not yet ready for it. So to try and like smooth out those first contacts so it doesn't go into that bad threatening lawsuit phase and gets into the good cooperative phase, or at least minimize the time in the middle.
In the US particularly, the liability insurers are a huge actor, and they're pretty unpredictable. And figuring out how to get liability insurers to take the approach you want is really powerful. One of the problems that one of the huge problems we have right now is ransomware, and the reason we have the ransomware problem is because liability insurers are seeing fit to pay ransoms, right? And every ransom that gets paid pays for 100 more attacks. So it's spiraling out of control because the liability insurers went the wrong way on that. But with stuff like vulnerabilities, you could see that going the right way a lot more easily, that an insurer, you know, having been informed of a liability in a product that, you know, they're insuring the manufacturer of against liability, you can imagine them saying, oh, well, actually, you know, you, the manufacturer or insured party, needs to clean this up, right? Not just sweep it under the rug.
Yeah, I would love to see it if there was an insurance program that would try to reduce the risk that, mm-hmm. you know, they saw it in their interest. Oh, we have a question out here, yeah.
Sorry, ask question now or later.
Yeah,
around table.
Maybe just say hi and who you are, or
sorry.
Say hi and who you are.
Hi, my name is Armin. For until previously, I was at the CERT Coordination Center for 2 years. A lot of coordinators were from Berkeley.
I have personally chased down industry sectors to try to socialize exactly the pattern you just described before it happened to them. So with some partial success. Just an immediate response, one idea could be, and I think this has maybe worked a little bit, at least in the industrial control systems, OT space, this, a little bit of success here. I don't know who does this, right? This community, an actual somewhat planned campaign, go to the medical device sector, go to auto, go to aviation, go to their conferences, don't expect them to come here, find their trade industries, any channel you have, and multi-year concerted campaign to introduce these sorts of things. So maybe the first time through, they're not completely surprised by it. But I've many times seen what you both described as the reaction. I didn't know we used computers in our things and in that response. There's a paper I've partially read. I think it's called Blessed Are the Lawyers, for They Shall Inherit Cybersecurity. It's a great title. Well, but here's the point, right? It gets to the liability question, and I've seen a little bit of this as well, right? So vendor has a vulnerability or they get compromised, and right, there's their in-house legal is there, the IR law firm's legal is there, the insurance company's interested. If no one else sorts this out, maybe eventually, right, civil courts might end up defining, maybe slowly over time, hey, company X, you made an honest mistake, the best nation state malware on the planet got you, you were doing all the good things, that was an accident, you're off the hook. Or I knew about a public vulnerability that was patched 2 months ago, I didn't get to it, there was a high threat for it, and I didn't patch my stuff and I got popped. You lose. And honestly, my opinion after 20 years is, if it costs enough to lose out, that'll make a change. Lots of techniques we could do today, we don't, because the motivation and the price model is not that you get punished enough. For for screwing up cybersecurity really badly. Yeah. If there's a way to help define that minimum liability line, I'd love to work on that or your
subsidiary. So, one thing you said that was really interesting is this increasing the cost of the failure, and it makes a lot of sense. And I think you can fail cybersecurity from what, I mean, in many, many ways, right? One of the ways you can fail is just not patching. But another way you can fail is never, I mean, it's related, but never looking at your systems from an adversarial context. And so if you're talking about insurances, something popped into my head when people always tell me, like, when you replace your roof, you tell your insurance agent, and your insurance will go down. I've never experienced this. I've told my insurance agent, he's like, great to hear. But maybe it's something like that when you do a pen test. And I guess now that I say it, it sounds, this already does happen, right, with insurances. But maybe what we can actually do is when you receive a disclosed vulnerability in your product from the community, to encourage this sort of community involvement, to bring it back to how do we close that shock of first contact, the liability insurer actually says, hey, actually, if you receive a properly disclosed vulnerability, that's a good thing for you. Maybe that can reduce your risk and lower costs.
Many insurance companies now have to think about whether the company has a background.
Yeah.
Well, one thing with liability insurance and cyber liability insurance that we're seeing is our CISO, from a legal perspective, we're ending up with a lot of the privacy controls are starting to drive what the liability insurance does. So GDPR is a prime example of that because it carries both the physical liability and the corporate liability with it. And that's where we see a lot of the changes starting to take place with regards to policies around privacy. Not necessarily InfoSec, because they don't understand it, but they do understand privacy. So a lot of drive and a lot of focus in that area because of these large data breaches like Adobe, LinkedIn, and others is where we're seeing that traction take place. But with that in mind, I mean, it all starts with how do you close the door.
Yeah.
So I just highlight one thing. I appreciate what Art was saying about the difference between you getting popped by a nation state that there's basically nothing you can do about it and make not patching something for months, and also like putting in places things like bug bounties, as Amit was saying. Is that what we want to actually incentivize is having good practices, having the most well defended system. And one of the things about where problems occur is it's not distributed necessarily according to how your practices are. Sometimes you have the best practices, but you also have a high value target and you get popped by something that's very difficult to defend against. Sometimes you have the worst practices and just happen to get popped. And so how do you tie it so you're incentivizing people to take the practices, do things, the patch comes out, you take care of it immediately, you open yourself to finding out that information and act on it, but focus it on incentivizing doing the things that would defend with less, whether you actually got popped is, an interesting aspect of it, but it's not necessarily meaning you have bad practices or are good practices.
Well, that sort of ratio of risk and cost is exactly what insurance companies, in theory, are good at dealing with. And, I've got a manufacturing facility, and the liability insurer for that does an annual audit. They send an expert who comes around and says, the last one, said that we had a broken window that was, window pane was adjacent to a window latch, right? And I guess none of our guys had noticed that, right? But that was, on a long laundry list of little things that ought to be fixed up. And that was someone the insurance company employed, the insurance company sent them. It was just part of the insurance company's business. Right, but they're not thinking that way in cyber yet. They're thinking that way still in physical realm, but not in cyber risk.
To bring it back a little bit, one of the things that we've seen that's been successful at Black Hat and DEF CON was, in the early days, US CERT, when they were still around in their old form, we would get, a researcher would say, I've disclosed to the medical manufacturer, they don't believe that this is a problem. It's really a problem. And I don't want to dump it publicly. Can you talk to the manufacturer, US CERT? You know, study my results. Go and talk to the manufacturer. They might believe the message if it comes from the government. And so there is this partnership role in which maybe the government can validate the finding of the crazy researcher and then deliver that message to, and it's different when US CERT's calling the CFO than Rando. And so I think there are some tangible outreach style programs that would increase the credibility of the government, increase the accessibility by the, you know, private sector. Right.
So it might be then, kind of to bring it back to that first contact scenario, it might be worth preemptively identifying sectors that haven't had their kind of you know, moment in cybersecurity, and preemptively reaching out to the big actors and saying, hey, let's build a channel so that when this inevitably happens, and it'll happen to you eventually, there'll be a less shocked response. We'll be ready to go. Awesome. Hey, look, we're already boom.
Drinks on me. There's this story about the voting village. I'll go back to that because it seems relevant. When we wanted to try to grow the voting village community, we figured we had to reach out to the municipalities that actually are running all the election officials. There was no list of election officials. There was no list of what all the counties were and who to contact to. So one of the people, Jake, who helped form the voting village, with his own money from his company and five employees, they tracked down the 8,000, or no, it was, I think it was 6,000 or so, but we made 8,000 contacts, phone calls. We physically mailed every single one of them in the country a piece of mail explaining what's going on at the voting village. You're invited, you can come, everything. Like, that wasn't being done by the government, it wasn't being done by anybody. None of these groups that had been around for 15 years that were championing voter transparency had done that either. It's like Jake with his budget, right? And that brought about two dozen officials, and that was the sort of the beginning. Well, now there's CISA and different, everybody's jumped in on it, but I mean, it was like a storm that got us voting machines, and Jake with some budget started the whole community off. Now, it probably would have gotten there a couple years later, maybe, but I think there's a lot of ripe opportunities like that, where it's just somebody with some initiative and 10 grand and some phone bankers.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, I wonder, I think we might have some feedback if we are too loud. Yeah. I wonder if there's something there, going back to how, what's crazy to me is the whole voting village was a convergence of like two random events that enabled it.
But like, remember ATM hacking?
Yeah.
Was a thing for a while because none of the ATM manufacturers had thought about security. Well, we don't see ATM hacking talks much anymore. It's kind of been
success.
Yeah. Mostly figured out, or people have moved on to something else. So yeah, I would be interested in the first contact principles, but I mean, as a policy connection between the two, I think it's more about building, remember when we, eons ago, there was like a cyberstorm exercise between the civil society and the people who run the internet and government. And the most important thing is building relationships and building trust. And because if there's a big problem, you want to pick up the phone and know you're talking to someone. And people generally, at least in our communities, don't trust organizations, we trust individuals. And so I'm not calling the FBI, I'm calling somebody I know specifically in the FBI that I trust to not get me, you know, sideways. So half of this is, I bet, building relationships. So when something goes wrong, right?
Yeah.
So part of the conversation could be, how do you build relationships? And how do you get the government to recognize some consistency in relationships that are important? Like, when I lived in DC, I spent 3 years trying to build relationships at all these different agencies. mostly on internet governance related topics. And I swear, every 6 months, the person I just spent 5.9 months getting up to speed moved on to another, got rotated. And I'd spend all my time just trying to figure out, well, who's in charge now? And then get on their calendar and then get up to on speed on the issues. And then just do that for a couple of years and you're burned out. And so where Woody has always been Woody, he's been doing that forever. There's a consistency on one side, but the other side, it just seems like there's a forever churn. And it, that makes it hard.
Everyone in Washington, D.C. is perpetually 23 years old. It's like always September on the internet. One of the things Jeff just said, I mean, the original topic of this roundtable was going to be how to give advice to government. And, you know, governments periodically ask for advice because they're all 23 years old and, you know, they're just out of school and they want to know what their job should be. And so, like, they ask industry, hey, what should we be doing? And industry always says, you know, there was this thing. It was called Cyberstorm. It was great. You should do it again. And they're always like, la, 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 we can't hear you. That was when we were in kindergarten. And it, for some reason, like this just goes around and around and around. Every time government asks for advice in the US, the private sector says, Cyberstorm, that was great. We should do it again. And government says, you know, we'd really like to have some advice from you.
Well, there's this, I run into this as well. There's this feeling that, hey, we already did that and we stopped doing it. So why would we start doing it again, right? And that feeling is, that there's examples like this all over the place. In the research field, there used to be this awesome program called Cyber Fast Track, where DARPA would give small awards to very quickly to small teams to do cool stuff. And then it stopped, and it was awesome, and everyone wants it back, and it's like, but why would they do it again, right? They already did it, they stopped.
Yeah.
I wonder how we would, I mean, that could be like a government agency standing up and say, hey, we should look back at things that worked and for whatever reason stopped being done.
Part of it is that government tends to reward novelty, right? Like, if you're a politician, you got to propose something new and, you know, get support for something new and get momentum for that. And then, you know, you're on to the next thing. Whereas if you're in operations, you need continuity, right? You want to know that if we got something going, that we don't have to like constantly tend it, that it will have some momentum and it's not just going to fall apart the moment you look away from it. So, I mean, that's a fundamental difference between the private sector and government, in that government doesn't really reward spending that money again next year. Mm-hmm. Because if you spend that money again next year, then that money is not available next year for something flashy and new that you can, you know, get elected on. But I think people like continuity.
I think citizens like continuity.
Yeah. So, I mean, this...
Well, I wanted to bring up one other thing.
Yeah.
When we talk about government, we're not just talking the U.S. government, and there's a tendency to think myopically, but these policy issues are global in nature, and the problems that we face, pretty much every government faces. And I like to say that, you know, internet problems are global problems, and so we're going to have to talk to the other governments of the world if we want to solve some of them. And that means talking to China and Russia, whether we like it or not. So you probably need to have mechanisms and ways of communicating to other, you know, more so China, because they're a major manufacturer of the technology. So if you're going to try to fix a problem, it's probably going to be potentially to manufacture, that's probably going to be a Chinese company. So we should keep that in mind, that a lot of times I've seen it where there's ideas in the States that don't work very well or don't get much traction, and then Singapore does it, like a labeling requirement for software. And then it's like, oh good, somebody else did it, first mover, now we can talk about it, now we can do it. And so it's almost like venue shopping as hackers. Fine, we'll talk to people in European Parliament, we'll talk to people, wherever it takes, right, to move the ball forward. And I remember talking to a member of European Parliament, and I explained what we did, this voting village. It had just happened. We had the report, and he said, oh my God, I would love to have that in Europe, because what I get is a report from a trade group and I get a report from like a special interest, and there is no civil society counterbalancing report. Now, I want to not do what's in these two. I want to do this third thing with a little bit, but I can't point to a third thing. I can only point to these two things. And if you could give me a scrap of paper with a scrawl on it, anything I could point to, that would make my job much easier. So I'm thinking that just sometimes trying to get a five-page report out that says experts in the room think X, we think that's trivial and not in-depth, that might be hugely valuable to other governments or other legislators.
It's interesting. Even if we produce it here.
I think
so. I think we have one, two, and then we over there.
Yes, please complete the
thought. Huh? Yes, I was going to say, it's interesting that outcomes that we produce here in the context of this community or the U.S. government, et cetera, can kind of spread and have impact beyond and maybe bootstrap those conversations. Because what you could probably do is then leverage that connection and that interest of that PM in Europe to start up some sort of a long-term communication with them. Super interesting. Yeah, it's, I think as hackers, we're often not very good at organization. That's something that takes a lot of organization that I think, but it's a great idea. Yeah.
We have a question down there.
Yes. Actually, on that point, I'm Nicola Price, because you just said it's civil society as well. I think to that part of our organization, there is a bridge that's been built to the electronic frontier foundation. Now, speaking of the European guideline, I think there is an office in Brussels that's been created. It takes time, it's slow that industry, but it's still possible. And overall, we should probably change the mindset, it shouldn't be accidental. This should be a systematic input to the policy today. And I think that's basically like very robust civil society presence, like the electronic frontier foundation or like other civil society that is maybe that is developing right now. We are actually moving forward. There are also other channels where the industry is not as present, and therefore like advocacy is a bit more it's less crowded, and there might be a access. For example, the OECD, I don't know if any at this front of the have been interacting with the OECD, which generally has been quite good at this kind of more technocratic policy topics, which then make it to the law, like after 5 or 6 years, like digital taxation or negotiation that may take place there. So I'm wondering whether this level of organization is difficult, but there is not enough tax to the society, there is not enough pathways to actually make that happen. The balance issue is one that you mentioned as well. It would be a matter of making sure that there is coordination and that there is as you said, a personal relationship with the OECD, a personal relationship with the European Commission that could facilitate a lot of this work. So yeah, I don't know if the Electronic Frontier Foundation has a plan, a strategy of policy
outside the US, and whether this could be maybe funded, but I'm sure there are crypto village, but there's a lot of people willing to fund this this type of program, and open a program for facilitating like independent hackers, because you mentioned industry reports as well, but clearly industry reports would not mandate anything for best practices for cybersecurity, unfortunately. Unless they really want to do trade value, generally they want to mandate the least possible efforts. So yeah, I think we can get together and probably get a lot more like a momentum behind this. It shouldn't be accidental, like, no, we have
one pointed out was identifying where we might do policy, where it's more ripe with, say, villages or something. And we've tried this in the past. We've talked to different government committees and said, what would be useful for you? And they'd say, okay, AI and automotive are really coming up in the next Congress. We want to, you know, those areas would be great. Okay, so we go to the AI village and the auto village and we say, hey, let's try to write a report. And you quickly realize, they don't know how to write reports, right? And so then we're like, aha, here's an opportunity. Okay, so DEF CON, we can go find people from the policy world to help work with them, to help write reports that then can get released. And so the first time we tried with the AI villager report was a disaster. We never released it. But we're thinking maybe one of the things we can do is help, like the community can still come up with these ideas, but if policy people say, you know, next week or next year in Europe, it's going to be all about cryptography. Oh, great. Okay, let's do a work, you know, consensus. What do the experts at DEF CON think about this? And we'll find think tanks or we'll scare up some money. We'll get some policy people. I think that's probably more realistic at these early stages than starting a new center of something. Yeah. Wait, I think she's been waiting the longest.
Yeah.
So valuable was because, one, it was timely, two, it was just out of curiosity, you know, hacker curiosity. I've only been coming to DEF CON since 2016, but it seemed to me that in 2017, when that voting machine village started, the community changed a little bit. We got in people from the news, you know, from politicians, more politicians, who were interested in voting machines. So, and you built community through the badge. There are a lot of people here, I think, who are suspicious of organizations. Maybe deservedly so. But you've got community through the badge. And you've got a world, a global, I don't know how many countries are represented here today, but I think Black Hat had 111. So there's already an international pool of intellectual capital, property, whatever, smart people who think outside the box. Who like to break things, but also maybe have a heart for making the world better. I think that's a very valuable culture at DEF CON. And I think, you know, you've created it and I think you'll keep it. But I think that could underlie maybe the way policy gets thought about.
So it's really hack the planet and then fix the planet.
yeah, exactly. No, I think the nice thing about doing it at DEF CON is hacking is kind of, it's actually a weird thing to say now that we have the rise of nation states waging cyber war functionally against each other, but hacking is such a fundamentally international thing. I was once at a conference in Shanghai and I said, I was giving an opening talk and I said, you know, packets don't care about national boundaries. There are certain people at that conference got very nervous when I said that. But it's kind of true, right? Like for the, you know, the community at least.
Yeah, just to kind of mix and bring these points together. So, you know, what is, so cybersecurity is a team sport, right? There's no version of this, whether you work for a corporation, you work for yourself, whatever, right? We're all here because for different reasons, but essentially we're a little bit better place. I mean, we all kind of generally agree with that. And I think while there are a lot of people who are suspicious of groups and organizations, there's not a bunch of tolerance for that, right? In order to change the system, you must be participants in the system, right? And that's just the way it is. And the reality is that there's enough of us that are working inside the system, helping them mold and shape future policy methods and practices. And, you know, the bottom line is, we've just got to have ways to build trust and relationships, as Jeff can point out, right? Big part of the game is, if you don't have those, you know, personal contact relationships, you know, it's hard for you to build on those and reflect the message better. And to me, when I think about areas where we can improve and optimize this, is I think about like ISA.org or other large communities or cybersecurity, you know, they have ISA for cybersecurity, right? They have other, you know, the Electronic Foundation, right? There's other groups, but we need to create something that allows for the message of these types of activities. And to your point, I have a column of interest for next year. AI, there's European AI law, right? There's the cyber resilience law. Okay, we know what they're doing. Spend a little money, put that as next year's topic, right? And let's devote in energy and trusting corporations, people, humans, others, all want to participate in that and help make that better, because nobody wants a bad answer, right? And I think if we get enough of the right people, and to your point, plan ahead. Think about what we need to get, what's coming, legal, regulatory wise, and then make sure there's actually communities to actually respond to it. And then we can go along that platform. Would love to see these kinds of communities also in like camps or where we can just in a room sit, hey, hi, my name's Matt.
This is the perfect time to say, Track 2 at 6 o'clock, there's a policy reception with free beer, but don't tell anybody that. Because it's supposed to be for people who are interested in policy, not the people who are not in this room kind of thing. But it's after the last talk, Track 2 and the Secure Signal messaging app are supporting it because they're getting more interested in this stuff. So tell your policy buddies, Track 2, 6 o'clock, and more community building with alcohol.
And so I wanted to riff on something you were saying. Like working within the system, you can make some effective change. I get that. But I think there's also a bunch of people who are mistrustful of organizations, and they need some help interfacing with that. And I think both of it is one of the things that is be good for the community, and people have tried to do this in the policy track and doing some, is get people engaged individually in the system. They can talk to their representative. They can get engaged directly. But I think also, as we're riffing off on, saying about like the AI report was not perfect the first time around, is that also helping people in the community who can do the research, who can find the stuff, who want to make the world, but they're not sure how to like coalesce this and present that in a good form, have that interface that like we want the technologists to be able to give their opinions, but make it effective. And sometimes there's a little bit of an art to that. So having some ways of either getting communication between these groups, but investing a little bit, and I think a lot of people here in the policy space can be part of that solution, getting involved with the community groups and helping them get involved in making reports and making a difference in a system that they may not be familiar with and maybe even mistrustful of.
So I think we have a lot of subject matter expertise in this spread out. I think the EFF is a perfect example. We once did a research paper where we broke a bunch of digital rights management automatically, right? You might remember because we worked with you. Because when we tried to publish it, the conference refused to publish it until the EFF kind of signed off that this is all good. And through you, we worked with all of the vendors of the DRM that we broke, right? So the EFF is one body like this, but the EFF kind of has a more scoped mission. It sounds to me increasingly like more and more what we need is a some sort of organization that makes connections, like a policy routing. Exactly. Like we get them all in a room with free beer, maybe.
I mean, this is kind of what CPSR is.
Yeah.
You're going to say something, Bill?
I was just going to say that that's kind of what CPSR was, but Like, what happened with CPSR? I don't really even know the story.
It used to be like a key conference that everyone went to and it sort of faded away.
Yeah, Computer Professionals for Social Responsibility.
Right. And they would, like, in the early days, they would make sure that, like, the ergonomic seats were made and employers had to provide, you know, monitors, and, you know, like, they were worried about social
really
responsibility.
Yeah.
And they kind of disappeared. There was another one, too. There was EFF made three. It was the third to arrive on the scene, and I can't remember what the very first one was. Epic.
Hey, Epic's still around, but they're very small.
Epic. What is that? Electronic Privacy?
Information Center.
Information Center.
Yeah. But how do we get more light shine onto them? Do we say, like, does a government agency made an official recommendation that people from around government and industry go to these places, or?
I mean, we should ask the government people, how do you find your civil society counterparts? I mean, I'm assuming industry is constantly bombarding you with freebies, and we don't look and sound like what you normally see as industry. So how do you even find us here?
This is the problem. So I'm currently working with our host for a very long time, and you're exactly right. We are constantly bombarded by somebody trying to sell you something. And so as a consequence, they develop a shell around them, which is inured to the effect of somebody actually trying to help. And so you need to trust a third party in order for that to be, that does not have another agenda. EFF, as an example, I mean, I've been coming to the conference 20 years because I thought it was important that I did the right thing, that I engaged with people that were trying to do the right thing and to figure out the best approach. So there needs to be a different level of outreach. And I'm willing, in my new role, to help with that. So I'm a cyber practicing for a contract in the DC area. And so these things are interesting to me, having been on the other side, now trying to do the right thing. But we need an independent entity that is able to host a con, or even gather birds of a feather session, something as simple as that, in major centers, to bring together folks from the community, folks from industry, and government, hosted by somebody like EFF. Not to put you on the spot.
We're all part of it. I think EFF alone is not, is just part of a larger system that we need to help develop to get these things. We do some work, a lot of work in the U.S., more so overseas, but there's still a lot of interfacing that can be done. And I think that's why I say, like, this group that I'm bringing together here is actually a really important part of this.
It's really tricky when you're dealing with government to sort of retain that neutral, trusted third party kind of role and still get work done on important issues, right? That there's a balance to be struck. And the problem is that, I mean, for the EFF, I think the problem is that the EFF, because of who its donors and members and so forth are, is called on to take a strong position on critical issues, right? They're very active. And so then, in DC, that gets viewed as, oh, they're at one end of a spectrum and we need, a balanced approach. So let's go and ask the Koch brothers what they think, right? Or whatever, right?
I agree completely. And the reason why I bring that up, I've been a long time supporter, is because of my interaction with them and how they work. I understand there's an adversarial relationship with certain aspects of the government within the EFF. But that's okay, because that's that necessary, that polarity, you need that balance. And so, if not them, who? Because I used to work for the legislature of California, and I decry regularly, how can I get you to listen to what I'm trying to tell you? Even though I'm on the side, my interest is yours. You're not viewing me as a trusted third party, but at the same time, who else are you going to listen to?
What one of the most valuable things that the peer security community factual things, like technical analysis, like reviewing code, finding vulnerabilities in voting machines. What a turn of phrase we use, instead of saying speak truth to power, speak tech to power, to be able to explain how the technology works. Now, absolutely, EFF has, policy positions, and we try to, promote them. And in, in some cases, we're in opposition, on a government position. But the tech is still the truth. Of these, going back to the voting machine example, because I think it's a really good one, it's literally finding the vulnerabilities, proving up what had been said before, but providing some evidence to it. And a lot of people who were doing it came from the academic community, so I think they also knew how to write things up in a way that maybe not everybody in the community does. But getting that information, so even also if government receives factual information and buys into that, they make a policy. You might disagree on the policy choices, but at least it's being based on how the technology works. And some of the worst policies or trouble ones is policymakers are doing it based on a misunderstanding of how the technology works.
Existing backup in space, it's really hard to do this. And you know, one group you didn't mention. It's national security, it's economic growth, it's health, it's also civil society, which we touched on, right? It's journalism, it's rights organizations. Those are the kinds of things that, at least from the like foreign policy side of the US government, that's now catching up on the cyber savvy, right? We hear everyone's conversations that we're going to be interested in finding ways, both from the community, but then also internally, it's my day-to-day struggle, is trying to explain cyber in a way that keeps the people who are really passionate about their own technical, their own hackers in global health, and that's what I mentioned. So I think that was really important. The last part that I would say is so much of the advertisement on cyber in DC is like around CISOs and stuff, which is its own little kind of subculture where they have the like management people that handle my computer, but like, that's like 10% of the organization. The other 90% is trying to do other work and they're all on their own, just making sure they're not in the
So. We keep coming back. Oh, you had your hand up? Yeah.
I'm Gar, former intelligence official, now working in the NDA. One of the problems we have too is that a lot of the technical expertise and knowledge related to engage with you guys is at the working level. And when you're in the DoD or the intelligence community and you're trying to engage with someone from civil society, there are so many hurdles to getting into that for security reasons. When you're concerned about insider threats, you're concerned about like choices, about doing illegal things, etc. That makes it really painful for someone trying to engage. On top of that, even in budgets, right? So I had to work very hard to get the budget to come out here this week to a conference in Vegas for, you know, 5 days, 6 days, or whatever. That cost us, what, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000? That's not going to happen very often for a level of engagement. So it kind of, it's another barrier that we face too with engaging in U.S., particularly out here. We could do more of that in D.C., probably help out better attendance. Just some thoughts there.
I just wanted to follow up with you. Yes, I think one of the challenges with consultations is a very long time, and it requires a very different set of skills and even confidence. So there's a difference between an ISCO and OMB. Definitely an EU government legislation consultation, the scope of NS2 or the Cyber Resilience Act, and depends on the jurisdiction. So, and there's also a lot of information out there. So one of the things that needs to be useful sometimes for the trade association is either a monthly or some kind of case report, the most significant consultations that are out there. Obviously, this is based on organization. So I think one of the challenges is, you know, the community we want to engage with specific deliverables that they view as most impactful, right? That's one review or two. And then by sharing this information that is accessible through consultation and pairing that with policy experts that can provide skill set to help to adjust that, then there's an opportunity to engage. And, you know, there's information, a lot of public consultations that go on Twitter, and NIST has done a tremendous job. This is just a great example of how they, and DHS as well, see some of the blog, and then how they collect comments via GitHub. So this is kind of a more creative way to get feedback, but maybe one of the opportunities or ideas is, can you kind of leverage trade associations and other policy experts that you know from your knowledge and kind of news item to create a monthly digest for the community, telling them what is out there in terms of consultations, as well as something that is more of a frequent cadence in local communities that pairs out the policy experts in the community who actually look at case studies or response. So that's a little bit more engagement than an annual, but it could be an opportunity to kind of address that.
And have like a Discord category, right? Because I think you mentioned budgets, right? And you know, having in DC will fix one aspect of it, but maybe not others, right? Someone over here mentioned that it's difficult to make these connections beyond these conferences. Maybe Jeff mentioned something along those lines, but maybe if we have a online community that's kind of, let's say, semi-vetted, but, you know, fairly open, to have these sort of talks much more frequently without the need to spend $6,000 to, you know, come to probably the worst city on the planet. it's, I don't know, do you think that would be useful, or is there like a, what's the downside there?
I found it's really hard to build community online.
Mm-hmm.
On the DEF CON forums, we've tried for years to build this community around aerospace and satellite hacking. And the people are out there, the content is out there, but nobody wants to sort of curate it. And unless the space has some sort of curated content, people don't really come back. And so it's like you need a budget, you need somebody, an intern, somebody whose job is to gather all the satellite hacking articles and papers and YouTube videos. And you have to create a critical mass, and then 2 years later, enough people might understand. We tried this with farm hacking, which turned into sort of right to repair. And you get a couple people who know what they're talking about. They post a couple of things, they get low engagement, and they never come back. And so it's not just like you start an online community.
Mm-hmm.
I've tried that many times. You need to have a core group of people that are posting all the time, cross-promote. I mean, it's a job.
And who want to get together in person to argue about it, you know, alongside meetings that they're going to anyway,
yeah,
periodically. I think, I mean, essentially that's what DEF CON kind of is. There's a whole lot of side meetings that all happen in the same place at the same time. But building on that and providing continuity through between meetings is I think,
so the part that needs to, you know, kind of more work. Power that, or a group needs to power. I nominate Luis. No, just kidding.
Again?
Yeah, it's a good.
Just a thought. I mean, the UK government, by the way, good job. You guys are part of the leader on PPPs, public-private partnerships. Great programs, works very well. US, not so much. We're trying to do better. It's going to cost all of us. But that construct is really goes back to groups and everybody show up and so you have to figure out how to build that trust. And so there is some amount of vetting. And so this also goes against people's grains, and then they'd be like, well, okay, I'm not going to expose all my stuff. But the reality is that if you want to participate, you know, in order to win, you gotta play. And so, you know, creating public-private trust kind of relationships becomes really important. Now whether that's .org or a community that does it, or whether it's a government that does it, you gotta do it. Because you gotta have some amount of vetting, some amount of evaluation of people. You can't just have some random group.
Well, that's the online is great if you've already met the people in person, right? And I think Bill and I were joking that one of the best trust building relationship exercises out of Cyberstorm would probably just be the beer and pizza phase.
Yeah.
Of Cyberstorm and all the computers and pretending you're running the internet and whatever, that's fine too. But really, the valuable part was actually the beer and pizza part.
I agree. And it's especially one-on-one because it's how you meet people, right? And I think the vetting becomes part of the dialogue because you sort of figure out, you know, there's this about satellite tracking systems, or this about, you know, industrial control systems.
Well, we're starting to run out of time, so let's try to figure out what's our sort of key takeaways.
Yes,
from both.
I just wanted to ask something. Like, we're talking about possibly meeting or promoting meetings and stuff like that. Maybe there is no answer for this, but if there are other meetings that are not related to cybersecurity, is there a way to have a cybersecurity breakout for these like different meetings that might or might not exist? Because people, that's a way to kind of start getting into the conversation, right? Maybe say, what are the cybersecurity implications for a certain thing, for a segment, or for an industry, or something like that? That's one. Possibly one way to start that.
I wasn't trying to.
I know.
So an interesting thing on that, and I think that goes back into a lot of what we talked about, is in order to organize that, I guess the effective way to do it would be you identify a the trade group meeting of X, Y, and Z industries or whatever, or groups, and then you go and reach out to them and say, hey, can we do a breakout, you know, a collaboration with DEF CON, for example.
So the Asian Village, now in its, I don't know, X year incarnation, the first few years was nothing but trying to convince industry that we're mm-hmm. safe and we're not going to burn you down. And now I think, Bo, you can maybe mention this, like, we're finally getting actual manufacturer representation. But that was because of years of prospecting to build those relationships, right?
And so...
Yeah, absolutely. And it also includes some of us going to their events, to aviation aerospace events. And Liz has also worked a lot on the aviation aerospace village and other things. And part of that was bringing them in early to the conversation. So it wasn't just a bunch of hackers sitting around the room. It was a bunch of hackers and a bunch of the really bold, really brave people from industry, from government, who were a lot of times doing it in their personal capacity because their professional capacity wouldn't let them do it. And you know, that's I think things are changing now in a lot of places for the better, where companies are starting to say, oh yeah, you can go and have those conversations, you can do that. That's cool, but not all at the same time. So some industries are farther along than others.
I think one way to frame what Louis said was, if we have we identify a bunch of outreach conferences that we can go to, and they're already there, they can't escape, right? And we just kind of set up in a room and say, hey, let's talk about security of X. I guess that could be a concrete next step from like a DEF CON perspective.
Sort of like do the DEF CON track at Aviation World or
exactly.
whatever.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
We did that once for what, the Tribeca Film Festival, around storytellers and directors and actors and everything. But yeah, there's precedent. You could travel. You know, we could have a
DEF CON on the road. So that's one common theme that. To summarize, that kept coming up is engaging with these other areas. The other common theme is maintaining relationships between people at different organizations across, like government, industry, government, and kind of citizen groups. That seems like a very hard problem. That. Maybe that's where we use DEF CON outreach. DEF CON goes and breaks into other conferences for doing the industry to security connection. And then we use like an online, I don't know, maybe just like, I see what you're saying about maintaining the online community, but there's got to be a solution to the person to person connections.
I've got to go to the gen history.
Yeah. Cool. Thanks for joining us, DT.
Yes, thank you, everyone. Don't forget, tell your policy friends tonight, 6 o'clock, track 2.
See you there.
That does not work. It does not be on the schedule.
It's secret. Yeah, otherwise, everyone would be there for beer.
I think one of the things that is really also exciting about the world traveling to DEFCON is going to be the continued emergence and organization of policy talks in our support.
I think, yeah, and that's very different than building out the, so it's also security community to security community that we got to connect. Cool. Anything we're missing in terms of the outtakes other than interconnectivity?
I mean, from Bo's comment, like there might be like something very simple, but to incentivize people whose employers don't want them
That's
to
right.
go there, is to say like, well, if you have an email showing that your employer does not accept you, like, I do not
suspend you.
And one more idea is case studies. You know, I found it really some series of very powerful companies and 2017 to talk about innovations for a bomb-based in this emergency to disclose they all to our community support. You just heard about the horrible case that you were going to the village and how that is a consultation between going through a case study that describes, you know, very specifically how the community engaged on something, what would change, and be really inspiring for the community to keep that engagement and who the heck of that case would take their any great place for these in the city and kind of going into the space.
And I guess that's the part of the point of the policy track in general. We can enable these sort of things at DEF CON. Cool, we got the 10-minute marker. Why don't we go around and see if anyone has any closing remarks on the panel or in the audience? Let's do audience first, so then we can get the real closing remarks.
Yeah, just one point. Yeah. If you identify several like institutions, like for example,
it might be both of the entirety of this organization, like, so, like, reaching out to the conference, say, like, you might consider a panel there, or what is to build the relationship there, because then we can have champions within the organization.
Yes.
For that for
hang on, I gotta know, are you Peter Stevens or not?
Sorry?
I have to know, are you Peter Stevens or not? You're not Peter Stevens?
No.
I'm not Peter Stevens.
Interesting. Okay.
I am this
one. Oh, okay.
Are you sure it's you and not him? I'm joking. Cool. Now that's a great idea. And I think that's probably one of the more actionable routes forward. Other closing remarks? Audience?
Just to say, OECD was mentioned a few times in mostly positive terms.
Yeah.
For constantly, you know why we're pointing at.
Cool. All right. Well, panelists, do we have any closing remarks? All right. Oh, heard that. Perfect.
Well, not really so much of a closing march. I just thank everybody for this conversation. I think, you know, brainstormed a number of ideas here, and I think we're trying to find a path forward to get better engagement. You know, minimize the problems with first contact scenarios, get the hacking community more able to be engaged, and I hope we can keep moving forward and make this happen.
I guess everyone filters out if you've got like. Business card and want to be notified if we create a DEF CON like policy Discord channel or whatever, drop it off and we'll do our best.
Post it to your Twitter.
Or yeah, respond to my Twitter. Awesome. And remember to like and subscribe too. All right, thank you everybody.
Thank you everybody.